acknowledge today that you are the way, the truth, and the life. You're the way to truth. You're the way to salvation. You're the way to redemption. You're the truth. You embody truth. You spoke truth. And you're life. You gave us life. You're the author of life. And we want you to be not only our way and our truth, but our life, the very essence, that we would depend on you so much, even as we depend on the very oxygen we breathe. And God, now we bring this offering before you as an act of worship. God, would you give us a greater ability to hold those material possessions loosely, that tithing and beyond would become a joy and easy because we desire to give our all to you and to invest in the mission of the gospel going here and throughout the world. So receive these gifts now as an act of worship in Jesus' name. Amen. Man, you may be seated if you're standing. As we receive the offering, I want to highlight on your announcement flyer today that next Sunday, beginning at 9 o'clock, we begin a new round of discipleship hour classes where you can grow in your relationship with God and be deepened. And so these are our leaders of the discipleship hour classes. They're listed on your flyer, but I want them to quickly share with you what they are offering. So Jonah heads up our children's ministry.
So starting next Sunday, I'm happy to announce that we are going to have a fourth and fifth grade specific class that's going to teach the Gospel Project. I don't know exactly which classroom it's going to be in, if it'll be over here or be in the children's building, but if you have a 9, 10, 11-year-old child that wants to be a part of that. So basically they'll come, they'll go through the Gospel Project, they'll have their own Bible study, and that will allow them to stay in the service during the worship time and the sermon. Also, we have birth to third grade that's going to be in the nursery. In the pre-K room over there, we'll be going through the Gospel Project and in that as well.
Awesome. Youth, led by Kevin Stout.
Yeah, we will continue in the Gospel of Mark. We're finally going to finish after a year. Yeah. So I'm not exactly sure yet. I'm waiting for a little bit of clarity on where to move what book next to. But what we do as a youth ministry on Sunday mornings is we move verse through an entire book in the Bible. We started with Genesis, then went to James, and then Mark. And I'm not exactly sure where we're going to go, but I would love to see any current middle school or high school student there. And also, we have a Wednesday night program we would love to see y'all at, too.
So. Awesome. Then for the adults, we offer Discipleship 101, which doubles as our membership class. I teach that, so it's the basics of following Jesus and then the basics of our church. And that's Discipleship 101, doubling as the membership class. Discipleship 201 is led by Shannon Hayes.
Yeah, 201 is us digging a little bit deeper, being strong. We have to have notes here. Being strong in the Lord, emphasis on the Holy Spirit working through your life, and then abiding in the Word. Digging into the Word of God and on a daily basis, and also overcoming the evil one. We don't want to be ignorant of Satan's devices. He wants to kill, steal, and destroy, and we want to know how to combat him with the Word and with the power of the Spirit of God. So it's a great class, so come be a part of that.
Then Discipleship 301, led by Pastor Jimmy.
Yeah, that's where you go really deep. Not 6 feet, but really deep. This is way beyond the elementary things of the faith. We're going to talk about the absolute sovereignty of God and how that plays out in our lives. We're going to talk about how to set up safeguards so that we may not sin. We're going to talk about lifestyle evangelism, lifestyle discipleship, and we're going to study and talk about how we live positionally, meaning rather than reacting to things and striving to serve God, we're going to be concentrating on how we live as though, and it's true, we already are pleasing to God. Mm-hmm. We already are established in Him. Mm-hmm. And we serve Him not as a way of gaining His pleasure, but because we have His pleasure.
Mm. And by the way, the Discipleship 101, 201, 301 is based out of 1 John 2, 12 to 14, where it says, I write to you children, I write to you young men, I write to you fathers. And so I believe that passage deals with levels of spiritual maturity. So 101 is more of at child level, 201 young man, 301 father. And then for the men only class, Raphael leads the class called a man and his fatherhood.
That's going to be the next series or the next volume in the series 33, which is a man and his fatherhood. There are so many things, even in the one before this, that talked about marriage that I learned. We brought the wives in, and they also picked up things that I think we all need to know. And I'd love to see us, you know, as men come together and know what God tells each and every one of us to do as far as raising our kids, raising our boys, raising our girls. He tells us what to do, and all we need to do is follow His word and follow, you know, some of the things that the experts that are going to be speaking on this and throughout this video are going to give us. I hope and pray that you would consider coming and joining us next Sunday morning.
All right. So pray about which class to be a part of next Sunday starting at 9 o'clock. And now I want you to watch this short video as you prepare your heart for the message, and then we'll have the scripture reading, and then we'll dismiss the children. Heads bowed, all eyes closed. Really want you to prepare your heart for what God would have to say to you today. Lord Jesus, we invite your presence through the Holy Spirit now. Lord, we love you. Thank you that you are an eternal God. You are from everlasting to everlasting. You have always existed. You will always exist. Thank you that you call us to live for more than just the here and now. Thank you that you allow us to invest our lives in things that will outlive us and endure for all of eternity. Thank you for giving us a calling, giving us a perspective, helping us to see things as you do. And I ask today in the name of Jesus, I pray the prayer, God, that the great Jonathan Edwards prayed, that you would stamp eternity on our eyeballs. God, would you do that today? Would you stamp eternity on our eyes, that we would see this life and the life to come as we never have before? I pray that through this message, decisions would be made. Young people would choose careers maybe differently than they had ever imagined because of what you do in this time. That decisions would be made about our time, our money, our priorities, even what is stated in our wills. Every facet of our lives would be impacted because of what your Spirit does in this room today. And I pray this for our good and your glory, and that everyone in the hearing of my voice right now would one day stand before you and hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." And that many, everyone here would be greatly rewarded in eternity because of what you do in our hearts and minds today in this very message, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, to take out your Bibles, please, and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians 4, we'll read God's word, and then the children will be dismissed that want to go to the Gospel Project time. If you need a Bible and don't have one, there's some in the back. You can go grab one. free for the taking. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to allow you to remain seated. I want you to look here for just a moment. Second Corinthians 4, verse 16. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen, for the things that are seen are transient. But the things that are unseen are eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to put on our heavenly dwelling. He's talking about our eternal body. Our glorified body. If indeed by putting it on we may not be found naked, for while we are still in this tent, or this human body, we groan, being burdened, not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. We must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. Children ages 3 years through fifth grade that want to go to the Gospel Project, you are dismissed at this time. Rest of you, take out your sermon notes. Keep your finger in the text today. I share today a message that has had a huge impact on my life. And I pray it will be a game changer for you. So I encourage you today to listen with the utmost concentration, and to allow the Holy Spirit of God to work and speak to you. It is the very truth today that I share that was a huge factor in my becoming a pastor. And the title of this message could be Eternal Perspective, or another subtitle could be What on Earth Are You Doing for Heaven's Sake? In other words, what are you living for that is eternal? Are you spending your life on what is temporal or investing in what is eternal? Are you spending your life on what is temporal or investing in what is eternal? A number of years ago, they asked people over the age of 90 a question. If you had your life to live over again, what would you do different? And as they compiled all the answers, three answers continued to reemerge. Over and over, people said, I would reflect more. In other words, I'd take time to reflect and think about things more. I would risk more. I would take more risk. And then the third one especially, I think, is significant. It says, I would live more for what would outlive me. I would give my life to things, and this wasn't even a Christian study per se, it was just people in general over the age of 90. I would live more for what would live on after me. I would want to leave a legacy. And for the believer, that would be eternal perspective. Giving our lives, investing our lives in things that not just live on after we're gone, like some leaving some great successful company. More importantly, investing in doing things that would last for eternity. Amen? And God put this in our hearts. It says in Ecclesiastes 3, God has put eternity in our hearts. God has put within every person the ability to think beyond the here and now. Now, we often camouflage that. We often cover that up. We often surround ourselves with so much of the here and now, so much of the material, that we don't hear that little voice inside, but God's put it in us. God's put within every person eternity. God's word reminds us over and over of how our lives are so short in comparison to eternity. The Bible uses language such as, our lives are but a breath. I used to live in Wisconsin. You wake up on a cold morning, you see your breath, then it's just gone so quickly. In James, it says our lives are a mist. Job 14 says our lives are like a flower that withers away. Psalm 102 says our lives are like a shadow. As soon as the sun moves, it's gone. Those are just some of the many ways the Bible describes our lives in comparison to eternity. In one of the two books that I've written, there's a chapter on eternal perspective, and I encourage people to do what I call the cemetery project. Walk through a cemetery this week. Look closely at the tombstones. Look at the dates. Figure out how long they lived. Ask yourself, does anybody even think about them anymore? And if they do, what do they think about them? What kind of legacy did they leave? Who even mentions their name anymore? And then look at the dates and look at that dash. What's going to happen within that dash, 1902 to 1985 or whatever? The dash is all we have. What will we do in the dash that'll go beyond that ending date? Yesterday, I had the privilege of speaking at a funeral. Interesting, the timing of that, and today. By the way, there's no one in here. We didn't bring that person here today. I open almost every funeral I do with Ecclesiastes 7, verse 2. It is better to go to a funeral than a party, for death is the destiny of every man, and the living should take it to heart. And I say, most of you would never have chosen a funeral over a party today. But the Bible says it's more to your benefit that you attend a funeral, because death is the destiny of every man. Everyone, if Jesus tarries, will one day face this. And the living should take it to heart. So when you're at a funeral, it reminds you of your own mortality. And the Bible says we should take that to heart. Not just mind, but to heart. To do that reflecting. So the central truth today, there's just one thing that God would have us take away. It's this: God wants His people to live with an eternal perspective. Matthew 6 says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, but lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy. Colossians 3 and 2, set your mind on the things above. Matthew 16, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? And the famous missionary C.T. Studd, I wish I had a name like that, C.T. Studd. I mean, that's a man's name right there, man, I'm telling you. He was a rich and famous English athlete who sold his entire estate to go to the mission field. Why? Because he says, only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Now, when you study a passage of Scripture like the one I read today, and this will help you in just your own time with the Lord, when you take a chunk of Scripture, look for repeated words, themes, phrases, concepts. Look for comparison and contrast that help you figure out kind of, here's the theme of this text. And today, no question, the theme is eternal perspective. Look at all the repeated phrases or words or concepts in this section that deal with eternity. Our outer self, that's our body. It's wasting away. Everybody over 50 says, amen. We have momentary affliction. Then it says eternal weight of glory. Then it talks about things that are seen or transient, things that are unseen or eternal. There's an earthly home. That's the body we live in now. Then there's a house not made with hands. That's eternal in the heavens. In this tent, it refers to our physical bodies on earth as a tent. It's a temporary place of residence. And then there's a heavenly dwelling, and that's when we get our glorified bodies. What is mortal may be swallowed up by life. So it's mortal versus eternal. Home in the body, away from the Lord, and away from the body, at home with the Lord, and then the judgment seat of Christ. Look at all the time, the ways that he speaks of eternal perspective. So you read a section of Scripture like this, you begin to note that and underline and use a color coding deal or whatever, and you go, wow,
Clearly, God wants his people to live with an eternal perspective. That's the focus of this text. There's a scene in a movie called The Dead Poets Society, where the late Robin Williams does something profound with his young students. Watch this short scene. It's powerful.
Gather ye rosebuds while ye may. The Latin term for that sentiment is carpe diem. Now, who knows what that means? Carpe diem. That's seize the day. Very good, Mr.
Meeks.
Meeks. Another unusual name. Seize the day. Gather ye rosebuds while ye may. Why does the writer use these lines?
Because he's in a hurry.
No. Ding. Thank you for playing anyway. Because we are food for worms, lads. Because believe it or not, each and every one of us in this room is one day going to stop breathing, turn cold, and die. I'd like you to step forward over here and peruse some of the faces from the past. You've walked past them many times. I don't think you've really looked at them. They're not that different from you, are they? Same haircuts, full of hormones, just like you. Invincible, just like you feel. The world is their oyster. They believe they're destined for great things, just like many of you. Their eyes are full of hope, just like you. Did they wait until it was too late to make from their lives even one iota of what they were capable? Because you see, gentlemen, these boys are now fertilizing daffodils. If you listen real close, you can hear them whisper their legacy to you. Go on, lean in. Listen. You hear it?
Holy Spirit is whispering to each of his children, carpe diem. Seize the day. Ephesians 5:16. Make the most of your time, for the days are evil. Make the most of your time. Talking to a man after the funeral yesterday, and he said, what do you think of this speaker? And I had never heard of him. And he showed me the podcast on his phone. This man was like 80 years old. And I said, I looked at the podcast. I'm like, man, these sermons are like an hour and 20 minutes. How do you have time to listen to that? His wife goes, he listens to it while he walks. That's making the most of your time. For the days are evil. Now, to lay a bit of a foundation, I want to quickly answer the question that's often asked. What is eternal? The Bible says that five things are eternal. First of all, God himself. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. God is eternal. Jesus is eternal. The Bible says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Second, God's Word. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of God abides forever. God's Word is eternal because truth is eternal. And what he says in his Word will stand true forever and ever and ever. Third, people's spirit. Whoever believes in him might not perish, but have eternal life. This body's not eternal. Our spirit is. And that's why the Bible says that when you die, it's described as absent from the body at home with the Lord. I'll never forget, Ralph and LaVon, do you remember when Peter Lord spoke at Watkinsville First Baptist Church? I love this. Peter Lord spoke and he says, you know, when I die, I don't want people coming by my casket and going, don't he look good? Don't he look good? He said, I want a sign in front of my casket that says, Peter Lord ain't here anymore. This is just the house he lived in. Never forget that. That's true. That person's not in the casket. The real person is gone to either be with God in heaven or awaiting the final judgment where their soul will be assigned to hell forever. So our spirit is eternal. Fourthly, this may surprise some of you, the Bible says godly character is eternal. 1 Timothy 4 and 8, this is for all you athletes and those that are really into fitness, and I think that's great, take care of the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is not anti-fitness, it's just saying there's something more important. Physical training is of some value, it is. But godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. What you invest in your character, godliness, is eternal because it will be rewarded. And if you want to learn about rewards for believers, read Aunt Randy Alcorn. There's no better author on the planet, in my opinion, on eternal perspective than Randy Alcorn. And then fifth, and it kind of encompasses all the others, Christ-centered ministry. Do not work for the food that perishes, but work for the food that endures to eternal life. In other words, anything we do that has to do with those other things, God, His Word, people's spirit, godly character, ministry to others, helping others develop in those ways, is eternal. What a privilege to give our lives for what's eternal. All right, now look up at the ceiling. You may not have noticed when you walked in. Do you see the rope? It goes from one end of the worship center to the other. This is a poor illustration because the rope, picture the rope going forever and ever and ever, going all the way to New York and all the way across the ocean. Now there's a little red ball. You see it? That represents eternity past. The rope beyond the red ball represents eternity future. The red ball is your little bitty life. That's your dash. And if we really did it justice, it'd be a teeny little line. And so my question to each of us today, me included, are you going to live for the ball or are you going to live for the rope? And are you going to do within that space what will last for eternity, or are you just going to be so focused on the little bitty ball and the houses and the cars and the entertainment and that sports team and all those things that can so consume our lives that at the end of the day, they will not last. It'll all burn up. Now, does that mean that those things are wrong in and of themselves? No. And that's why Ephesians 5 says, make the most of your time. You can redeem things. You're an auto mechanic and you're repairing cars, and that car, yeah, it's going to rust and it's going to eventually be in a junkyard. But that doesn't mean it's worthless that you're fixing the car. You can still fix the car, but as you're fixing the car, you're praying and you're investing in relationships and you're reaching out to people. Everything can be redeemed. There's nothing that we do that can't have eternal value if our heart is right. And so it's not so much the thing in and of itself. We're not meant to get legalistic about this and think, well, oh my goodness, I can't watch Final Four Championship Monday night because that's not eternal. Yes, you can, but you can redeem the time, for the days are evil. Watch it with an unsaved person. Watch it with others and be fellowshipping. Be doing other things during the commercials. Again, it's not meant to be this legalistic, paranoid deal, but I'm challenging you because we often don't think this way. And our world is so full of things that entrap us and keeps us from really living this message. My brother did a calculation when he was in college. In Psalm 90, it says 1,000 years is as a day and a day is as 1,000 years. So listen to this. If 24 hours equals 1,000 years to God, then a 70-year life is 100.8 minutes. So you live to be 70. To God, that's like 100.8 minutes. You can take a nap in a little over an hour and a half and not even know the time was gone. What a powerful image of our lives being a mist, a vapor, a shadow. So now let's turn to the text. Five things we pull out of this text as to what it means to live with an eternal perspective. And beloved, this is a game changer. This should affect the career you choose, young people. Those that are already in a career, this should affect Maybe how you stay in that career, whether you stay in that career, how you use the time within that career. It should affect what we do with our time, our money. Do you know that your will is your last act of stewardship? Are there eternal priorities in your will? Do you even have a will? If you don't, you better have one, or else the state's going to get everything you leave. So you write a will and you do it in light of eternity. Our will, 30% of our liquid assets go to whatever church we're involved in. Don't knock me out to get that, because I don't have much. But 30% of our liquid assets and our will go to the church that we are a part of. I love my kids, but I'm not leaving everything to them. Sorry, Sarah, Josiah, you don't get it all. Number one, living with an eternal perspective involves focusing more on the inward than the outward. It talks about the outer man, verse 16, the inner man being renewed. The inner man is our walk with God, our character, our spirit, our godliness or lack of godliness. The outer man is all that other stuff. It's the car, the house, the clothes. It's that outer stuff that's going to perish. And verse 16 reminds us that the outer stuff is wasting away. It's not eternal. I remember a few years ago, I went to my high school reunion. And I was shocked at how much I struggled with envy, comparing myself to some of my classmates, and some of them own their own businesses, or they have been on these exotic vacations, or traveled here, there, or wherever. And then some were actually already thinking about retiring, and because they were so well off financially. And I remember struggling with envy, and I was like, this is stupid, and I had to renew my mind. I had to remind myself of Luke 12, verse 15, a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. And so that's why this passage says we walk by faith, not by sight. If we just walk by sight, we can get distracted, but we've got to remind ourselves of what God's Word teaches and let the truth renew us, because the truth will set us free. Reminds me of the rich man who didn't understand this perspective. Very wealthy man, he called his three best friends together, knew he had only a few days to live. And he says, guys, I know they say you can't take it with you, but I'm going to do everything I can to take it with me. And so here's the deal. He gave each of them $500,000 cash. And he said, you promise me that when you walk by my casket, you put it in there. Slide it under the little sheet that covers everything but my face. So nobody will take it. They all agreed. Then after the funeral, they all met together. And they kind of, okay, did you do it? First guy goes, all right, I got to admit, I put $400,000 in there and I kept $100,000 for myself. Second guy goes, you did better than me. I put $300,000 in there and kept $200,000 for myself. Third guy goes, I can't believe you guys. We made a promise to our best friend. Well, what'd you do? He said, I wrote a check for the full amount and put it in there. If you didn't get that, it's because you've never written a check before. I realized, I was thinking about that story, there's some people today, they don't even write checks anymore. It's all debit cards and stuff, so they may not get it. If you didn't get it, ask a friend who's over 30. Number two, eternal perspective involves growing through hardships. It's interesting because the context of this passage, if you go up to verse 8, we're afflicted in every way but not crushed, perplexed but not driven to despair, persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed. Verse 10, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus. So the context here is somebody going through some pretty rough times. And then in verse 17, he says, for this light momentary affliction. And we go through afflictions, beloved. We go through hardships. Persecution, I believe, is possibly coming to believers in America. That there's difficulty. The context then, clearly this passage, is helping us have a different perspective, especially when we're going through affliction, hardship, difficulty. Okay? How do you survive and thrive in the midst of difficulty, here's how you do it. You let your sight be lifted above it, and you see beyond it, and you get an eternal perspective, and it's a game changer. It is a huge game changer. And so here it's growing through hardships. Now, hang with me. I'm going to get a little technical here, but in verse 17, he used some very interesting language. He talks about light versus heavy. He talks about momentary versus eternal. And then he talks about affliction versus glory. Now, the affliction doesn't feel light, does it? It feels heavy. It's hard. It's difficult. You feel the weight of it. But he says if you have an eternal perspective, then you have something that is heavier than the affliction, to where the affliction actually can look light. Okay? And then he says, and here's the key, is realizing the affliction's momentary. It's not going to last forever. Hallelujah. Even if you're killed or martyred, big deal, because absent from the body at home with the Lord. Paul said to live is Christ, to die is gain. And so you have this light versus heavy, then you have momentary versus eternal. And then you have, watch closely, affliction versus, it says, in comparison to the eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. So he's making this comparison, and here's the key. The word glory means to fully reveal the character and likeness of Jesus. It's the word picture of shining a light on an object so you see that object in its brilliance, in its fullness. And so if you put that in, anytime you come to the word glory in the Bible, put in to fully reveal the character and likeness of Jesus, you'll see it opens up a whole new meaning to that passage. And so here what he's saying is, through that affliction, through that difficulty, you're going to be able, if you have an eternal perspective and you keep your heart focused on Jesus, you're going to see Jesus more clearly. Your character's going to be developed through it, and it's going to help get you through, because you'll say, yes, this hurts. Yes, this is hard. Yes, I can't stand this, but I'm going to hold fast to God, let Him develop me through it. My ministry's going to be heightened because I went through it. And so there you, all of a sudden, you're lifted up, and you have a whole new view of that trial, and you say, it is light, it is momentary, because I'm focusing on what's eternal. I remember, as a new believer, 17 years old, being introduced to this very concept and this very passage. From the time I was 16 to the time I was 22, I had what doctors and dermatologists call chronic acne. Acne was so bad, they actually considered scraping the skin off my face as a means to help it get better. And then this drug called Accutane came on the scene, and it helped me incredibly. Thankfully, I've had none of the side effects they warn you about now. That time, they didn't have those. But I remember as a new believer struggling with chronic acne and my appearance and being self-conscious of that, and God began to put this eternal concept on my heart. And it didn't take away all the struggles, but I'll tell you what, it was a game changer, because I realized this body is temporary. And then when I went through a broken engagement and cried for 3 hours on a frozen lake in Minneapolis, Minnesota, pouring out my heart to God, why did I have to go through this? And he once again reminded me, this is temporal. It hurts, David. I'm here in the trenches with you. I know it's painful. I'm your father. You can pour out your heart to me. But this is temporal. And there's an eternal thing that I'm wanting to accomplish in it, that if you'll look at that, it will make this light, momentary affliction nothing in comparison to the eternal weight of glory that will be revealed to us. Beloved, this will make a difference in your life. I'm telling you. I know it here, and I know it here. If you will allow God to answer that prayer that Jonathan Edwards prayed, oh God, would you stamp eternity on my eyes? Your life will never be the same. I'm telling you, you can't go to a football game the same anymore. You can't take a walk the same anymore. You can't drive to work the same anymore. You can't look at a week of vacation the same anymore. It doesn't mean we can't still do fun things. That's not what I'm saying. This makes it eternally productive. Red Gretch is out feeding cows. And this is a game changer. Right, brother? You can be out feeding cows with an eternal perspective. Why have people throughout the centuries been willing to give it all and go to the mission field because of this and the gospel. Because it's an eternal gospel. And they go, I want my life to matter the most for all of eternity. Dave Drabecki was a pitcher for the San Francisco Giants. Left arm got amputated, ended his career. Eternal perspective was a game changer for him when he said, without Christ, I couldn't have endured it all. I find great comfort knowing we're here on earth for just a short period of time. Then I will go to a glorified body. All of this is temporary. Jackson, remember we were talking about Inky Johnson recently, the player that career ended, his junior year at Tennessee? I mean, this guy from the time he was 7 years old said, I will be an NFL player. He lived in a family full of poverty. They were 12 living in the home. He got to sleep on the bed one day a week. And he said, I don't want to continue this life. And he made it his vow from the time he was 7 to be an NFL player. Junior year in college, career-ending injury, still can't use part of his arm. But you know what? Go to his website, Inky Johnson. Listen to some of his YouTube speeches. The guy's an inspirational speaker for the glory of God today because of that injury and because he has an eternal perspective. If his focus was merely on that career, he'd have been devastated. He'd have probably committed suicide or done something that many people do when their earthly dream is shattered. But God had a bigger plan. And through that hardship, he put his eyes on Jesus. What are you going through right now that needs an eternal perspective? What are you going through right now that you need to put on a different set of glasses to see it through the eyes of God and not just your own eyes? Number 3, an eternal perspective involves looking more to the unseen than the seen. Now this is similar to the inward-outward point, but just a little different. Listen carefully. The seen is the affliction. The seen is the financial hardship. The seen is other people having more than you materially. The seen is the surgery or the car accident or the bad grade or the sickness or the broken relationship. But the unseen is the Lord. The unseen is the character God's developing in your life. The unseen is the prayers that are going up. The unseen is the way I'm growing in the Word or my heightened compassion for others. And that's why chapter 5, verse 7 says we live by faith, not by sight. Let me flesh this out very practically. It takes faith to choose to spend time in the Word and prayer versus watching a movie, because the movie's right there in front of you. It takes faith to tithe 10% of my income to God, because what is seen is that new car I'd rather put that money toward, or that bill that's staring me in the face. So it takes faith in the unseen to say, God, you call me to do this. I'm going to be obedient and trust you to provide. It takes faith to say no to a temptation that might yield immediate, present, seen pleasure. Okay? Whether that's drunkenness, immorality, an affair, it takes faith to say no because I want to obey God. I want to stay pure for my future spouse, or I want to stay true to my marital covenant. So I'm going to trust you, God, to meet my needs, and I'm not going to give in to this temporary seen pleasure. It takes faith to give of my time to serve the Lord in ministry, because what is seen is that extra hour I'd like to sleep instead of leaving early to serve in the children's ministry, let's say, or usher leading a small group. See how this works? That's why 5:7 says we walk by faith, not by sight. It takes faith to go to the mission field and leave what is seen, and leave sometimes even family pressure to stay. What on earth are you doing for heaven's sake? Are you living for the rope, or are you living for the ball? John Wesley was told by a distraught man, furiously rode on his horse, to tell John Wesley, Mr. Wesley, something terrible has happened. Your house has burned to the ground. Weighing the news for a moment, Wesley replied, no, the Lord's house burned to the ground. That just means one less responsibility for me. That was a man with an eternal perspective. It was Wesley who also said, I hope to die with only a few possessions, lest I be found a robber of God. He wanted his life to count for what was eternal. Now, this fourth one's huge. It's a biggie. Number four, living with an eternal perspective, involves longing for heaven more than earth. And this isn't just some pie in the sky by and by, you know, pump ourselves up. We're talking about reality, folks. Heaven is real. Jesus said, I go and prepare a place for you. A real place, a physical place. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would not have told you. A little over a year ago, we had the tragic death of Dee Dee's mother. And I'll tell you, the reality of heaven is a game changer. Does it still hurt? You bet. The Bible says we grieve, but not as those who have no hope. The Bible says, we learned it last week, 1 Corinthians 15, because Jesus died and rose again, so will all who are Christ's followers rise again. They'll receive a glorified body. You will live forever and ever with God Almighty. Hallelujah. Where there is no sin, no Satan, no temptation, no sickness, no cancer, none of that. It'll be forever and ever with God. And that perspective of heaven and a future home if you're in Christ. If you're not in Christ, the Bible says you will not go to heaven. That's what the Bible says. And that reality in this passage, that's why he talks about the earthly tent, heavenly home. And then he says, it's very interesting, he says, we groan. Chapter 5, verse 4. Do you ever groan? Not just because you have physical ailments as you get older, but I mean in your spirit, do you groan sometimes? Do you sometimes just get sick and tired of living on planet Earth? And the sin and the persecution and the ISIS killers and all the mess and all the anti-God stuff and hearing the Lord's name in vain. And sometimes, do you just groan? Do you just get tired of living here? Well, if you do, good. Because it's not your true home. If you don't groan a little, then it might be because this is so much your home that you never think about heaven. There's a balance. But there should be that groaning at times because we so long for God's kingdom, His fullness of His righteousness to dwell forever. And that's why Paul in Philippians 1, he had that godly tension. Remember in Philippians 1, he says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. I'd rather go be with the Lord, but I'm needed here for you guys and to minister and plant churches and disciple and pastor. And he felt this tension. That should be our experience. There should be that godly tension. I'd so much rather go and be with God, where His kingdom prevails forever. And yet I'm needed here and I want to do things here that matter for eternity. And so there's that godly tension. A story is told of a couple that was coming back from the mission field. They had served faithfully for many, many years. They were coming back to the shores of America. And as they came to the shores, there were people waving American flags and hollering and clapping and applauding, and at first they thought it was for them. But little did they know that Teddy Roosevelt was on the same ship on one of his many hunting expeditions. And so as they got there and realized it was all for the president, and nobody was there to meet them, they struggled internally. God, we've served you so faithfully, and there's no recognition, and they're just struggling in their heart. And then the man said he knew that God spoke to him. He heard this voice in his spirit. You're not home yet. You're not home yet. Yes, it hurts. Yes, you wish there was recognition, but you're not home yet. And beloved, this is not our home. The Bible says we're aliens and strangers. Our true home is with God in heaven. Final point. Living with an eternal perspective involves living with the final judgment in mind. Listen carefully, because this is the point many of us don't think about. Chapter 5, verse 10. Each one, verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. All will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That's Billy Graham. That's me. That's you. That's Hitler, that's Mother Teresa, that's Stalin, that's Osama bin Laden. All will stand before the judgment seat of Christ Jesus, not Muhammad, not Buddha, not Hare Krishna, not a pastor, not your parents. Jesus. Hebrews 9:27, it's appointed unto every man to die once and then the judgment. You die once, not twice. There's no second chance. Purgatory is nowhere taught in the Bible. Once you die, your eternal destiny is sealed, my friend. Martin Luther said there's only 2 days. Today and that day. And that day is the judgment day. John Tillotson said, he who provides for this life but takes no care for eternity may be wise for a moment, but he's a fool forever. Noah Webster, the brilliant mind who wrote the dictionary of the English language. I mean, seriously. This is the guy that wrote the dictionary. How smart can you get? They asked him once, what's the greatest thought you've ever had? Pretty good thought for a guy who wrote the dictionary. He said, I've thought about many things, but the most awesome, the most terrifying, the most shattering thought I've ever had is my personal accountability to God one day. In the Fox's Book of Martyrs, good book to read when you're going through tough times. This is a record of almost all the major recordings of martyrdom since 33 AD. Polycarp was the last surviving disciple of the Apostle John. He was martyred in 166 AD, burned at the stake. And here's what he said just before they lit the fire. 86 years I have served Jesus, and he has done me no wrong. How then can I blaspheme my King and Savior? Because they asked him to deny Jesus. You threaten me with a fire that burns for a season, and after a little while is quenched. But you are ignorant of the fire of everlasting punishment that is prepared for the wicked. Beloved, that's a person who had an eternal perspective and understood the final judgment. In a book that made a huge difference in my life, read it 1992 for the first time, Money, Possessions, and Eternity. Beloved, if you want to read the best stuff out there on eternal perspective, I'm telling you, Randy Alcorn's the guy. At the bottom of your notes today is his website, EPC, EPM, eternalperspectivesministry.org, I believe. In this book, he tells the story, and I'm almost done, of Alfred Nobel. He was a Swedish chemist who made his fortune by inventing dynamite and other powerful explosives which were bought by governments to produce weapons. When Nobel's brother died, one newspaper accidentally printed Alfred's obituary instead. He was described as a man who became rich from enabling people to kill each other in unprecedented quantities. Shaken from this assessment, Nobel resolved to use his fortune to reward accomplishments that benefited humanity, including what we now know of as the Nobel Peace Prize. Nobel had a rare opportunity to look at the assessment of his life at its end, but to still be alive and have opportunity to change that assessment. Let us put ourselves in Nobel's place. Let us read our own obituary, not as written by uninformed or biased men, but as an onlooking angel might write it from heaven's point of view. Look at it carefully, then let us use the rest of our lives to edit that obituary into what we really want it to be. Because when the final buzzer sounds, the game is over. You can't go back to replay the fourth quarter. But you can change things now that will edit your future obituary. three things that should result from today's message. Number one, you better be sure you're saved. You better be rock solid that you're ready to meet God. You better know that you know that you know that you know that you know that you've received Jesus, that you've put your full faith and trust in Christ alone for your salvation, and that you know that if you died today, your spirit would go to be with the Lord. Do you know that? Are you certain today? Are you ready for this? If not, repent of your sins. Put your trust in Christ alone. Receive Christ as Lord and Savior. Know that you know that you know that you are saved from your sins. Number two, be living fully for Christ so that you will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And number three, be involved in helping others follow Christ, investing in what's going to last forever, helping others know and grow in Christ. And that's why chapter 5, verse 11 says, "Knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others." Final thing, then we'll take a couple questions. Let me show you one more nugget in this passage to encourage you. Look at chapter 5, verse 5. "He who has prepared us for this very thing," that's eternal perspective, "is God, who has given us His Spirit as a guarantee." You know what I get from that? You can do this. Believer, you can live what I've talked about today. Because He who's prepared you for all of this is God, and He's given you His Spirit as a guarantee. He's put His presence and His power within you so that you can live with an eternal perspective. You're already equipped to do this. So be encouraged and give your life for what matters. Let's bow in prayer. I'm going to pray and then we'll take a few questions. God, I thank you for being an eternal, everlasting God. Thank you for our eternal home called heaven. Help us live, God, for what will last. Now I invite you to ask God to show you right now one thing that needs to change in your life as a result of this message. If you're not a follower of Christ, receive Him right now. Without Christ, your entire life will burn up. If you are in Christ and Christ is in you, ask Him right now, what's one area that needs adjusting in light of eternity? If you've received Christ today, if you're receiving Him right now, I invite you, make sure you put that information on that card in front of the seat in front of you and leave it on your chair so that I'll have that information and I can follow up with you. If today you're receiving Christ or you have questions about your salvation, put it on the card. Or if there's a significant way that God is speaking to you today, put that down so I can pray for you and maybe follow up with you. God, we thank you for calling us to something so huge as eternity. Lord, let this principle, let this truth never leave our hearts and minds. God, we praise you for the great privilege. What a privilege to live this out. Oh, that each of us will hear, "Good and faithful servant." God, that we'll look back from eternity, from the gates of heaven, and say, "I'm so glad that I made those adjustments I made in 2016. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, let's take a few questions, and then we'll close with a couple worship songs. Questions?
Hey, I'm Rachel. It's sort of a question, hypothetical. I mean, not hypothetical, but rhetorical. But I felt like when you were preaching, like I've felt this way before, that someone might feel this way, that they hear you and they know what you're saying is true, but then there's this, well, you don't know what I'm facing. Extreme difficulty financially, or health, or relationship betrayal. And so, I mean, how would you respond to that?
Yeah, a couple of things. Good that you share that, and share it with a trusted sister in Christ that can come around you and pray for you. I would say meditate on some of the truths that we learned today and ask God to give you His perspective on that. You know, ask Him to show you how in the midst of that eternal things can be accomplished. And I'm telling you, when He does, it really does affect. It affects your mind. It affects your emotions. It may not change the circumstances in and of themselves. Okay, that's what we want changed. We want the circumstances to change, but God wants us to change. And sometimes He doesn't change the circumstances until He changes us, because it's a test. I'm going to preach on that soon. The testing of the Lord. There's seasons of testing. And when we pass the test, then the circumstances change sometimes. Okay? So I would just say the truths that we learn will have an impact if you allow them. Soak in it. Just soak in it. And really pray, God, help me see this from heaven's perspective. It may be a character issue. It may be a ministry issue. It may be getting to know a different aspect of God. You know, I know that sometimes through the struggles that I've faced, sometimes as a parent, have helped me understand more the Father heart of God. Okay? And if I just focus on that struggle in parenting, then I miss out on what God wants to do in showing me His Father heart. You see? Good question, though. Very good question.
Did I really cover it that well?
All right, right over here, one more.
I think one of the things that stood out to me is, you know, this idea of, you know, using your time for God, you know, and you know, I own a business, so I think about my business as God's business and my employees and things like that. But oftentimes, and I kind of get this, but I'd like to hear you talk about it. But, you know, people think, well, I can't do that because I'm not an evangelist, or I can't share. And they don't. Mm-hmm. They miss opportunities. And can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah. You know, the first thing that comes to mind is prayer. I think we diminish the power of prayer. And we can pray anytime. You can pray when you're driving to work. You can pray while you're doing your job. And prayer has impact. It's a mysterious thing that releases the presence of God on a person or a situation. And so that's where I think it's that redeem the time for the days are evil. You know, and this is where ask God to show you how you can make things that seem just temporal eternal. And he may give you an idea that's way beyond anything I could even think of. You know, I've talked about things like listening to podcasts while you go on a walk, or maybe praying while you're driving to work, or instead of watching this show, you spend time with God, you know, but He may show you something that you've never even thought of, you know, meditating on Scripture while you're doing something. Just that practice of the presence of God that Brother Lawrence spoke of. He was a dishwasher in a monastery and wrote that profound book, The Practice of the Presence of God, that's helped thousands of people. And it was just that simple concept that I can pray while I'm washing dishes. I can commune with God while I'm doing this menial task. That's eternal. That's making something temporal eternal. And we can do that with everything we do. We really can. And I think a huge piece that we don't look at enough is our money. It says, don't lay up treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy. That's talking about money. That's a financial passage, but lay up treasures in heaven. And man, he rocks your socks in this book on looking at your money and your possessions through the grid of eternity. It's powerful, powerful. And then it's like, Man, I want to give to missions. I want to tithe in my local church. I want to be generous because as I do that, that's an investment with my finances. I don't want to just spend my money on things that are going to burn. I want to give my money for things that last forever. And man, when you have that concept, giving becomes a joy. It really does. And Alcorn, in his book, The Law of Rewards, says you will be rewarded for those investments. You will. There are five rewards talked about for believers in heaven. And some get them and some don't. And he says we should want to get a lot of rewards. And that's not selfish, that God puts within us the desire to do things to be rewarded. And that can be channeled into eternal things that's good and good motivation. Read The Law of Rewards. It's a teeny little book. You can read it in 2 hours. It'll change your life. There's not many authors I can promote more than I do Randy Alcorn. His book on heaven is the most extensive book ever written on heaven, ever. One more, Yearwood. Or, I'm sorry.
Yerger.
Yerger, thank you.
Yes. Pastor David, you know, this is like a question between a husband and wife, where a husband sees something that, you know, you look eternal. You want to think about eternal according to something that she wants, which to her is not like an idol, but it's brings real pleasure in her life. So there's a difference in viewpoint. You know, a husband needs to be sensitive to his wife. And so, what do you just pray together about it, or you know, when the husband says, "Well, I don't know if we should do this."
Yeah,
you
know? It's a great question. Says,
well, it's just something else. You know, that would bring me great pleasure and so forth.
You know, the way I want to answer that is, I think God looks at your heart, okay, and if your heart is to honor and love and cherish and bless your wife, even if it's something that, granted, not sin, but even if it's something that you might go, well, that's kind of temporal, that's kind of like not eternal, that's like, you know, how could you, but your heart is to please and love her, do it. Really bless her. And maybe in doing that, that's eternal in God's sight. And so I know that's a little bit maybe not how you expected me to answer that, but I think, but yes, in general, you want to be on the same page with things, like let's say it involves giving or those kind of things. But if you're not on the same page, and if your heart is to honor and love and cherish her, don't get so caught up in the temporal versus eternal in that one. I think it's eternal that you bless her. I hope that helps. All right. And all the women said? All right. Good way to end it. All right. I want you just to bow your heads and hearts. Because this little intro, you're doing an intro to Turn Your Eyes. Yeah. Just listen to this. The reason we chose this song at the end here is this line, you know, turn your eyes upon Jesus. And the things of the world will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. And so she's going to play an intro. Once we join in singing and standing, then the prayer team, if you'd be available along the sides at that point in this song.